Many Magic the Gathering players ask the question, what are your thoughts on the recent commander bans of Mana Crypt, Jeweled Lotus, Dockside Extortionist, and the other one? Well, today I'm going to be talking in depth about... What's that? Hello?
New secret lair alert! New secret lair alert! New secret lair alert! New secret lair alert!
New secret lair alert! Yeah, I guess that Tolarian wins can wait a few days. You know, I do actually like to sit for a little bit and consider new ideas, contemplate, hear the opinions of others before releasing my own insight and analysis. That's what I used to do with Secret Lairs, but then they all sold out on the first day of release. So we are covering all of these Secret Lairs before they are released. That's right. Every single secret lair that we're talking about in today's video has not yet sold out because they're not yet available for sale. As a result of this, however, many of the graphics and images are of a very poor quality. That's because for some reason unbeknownst to me, Wizards of the Coast likes to release promotional images as though they were JPEGs on America Online circa 1998. So don't complain to me if some of the secret lair images are poor quality. Complain to Wizards of the Coast. When will these secret lairs actually go on sale? Keep your eyes open. WotC likes to surprise you. And speaking of surprises, I'm giving away every single Duskmourne product on my next Whatnot stream this September 30th. All you have to do is show up and maybe you'll walk away with Play Booster Box or Collector Booster Box or Fat Pack. No, Bundle. Not Fat Pack, but other things, every commander deck. It's all being given away by me to you this September 30th on Whatnot. Whatnot is just like if Twitch and eBay had a baby. People list items at buy it now prices or auction them off during a live stream, myself included. And best of all, if you use my invite code at www.whatnot.com/invite/Tolarian College, you'll get a $15 credit to spend on any Magic the Gathering items in my store or anyone else's. So that's $15 to spend on any magic item on Whatnot that you want, as well as a chance to win any one of the many numbers of things that have been released with Duskmourne. And it's all happening in the Duskmourne Spectacular stream this September 30th on my Whatnot channel. Use my invite code to claim your $15 prize and maybe, just maybe, walk away with some free Magic the Gathering swag. And now...
New secret lair alert!
That's right. Let's see if any of these secret lairs are worth it financially to buy. First up, Hatsune Miku returns, this time with friends. This secret lair drop has 5 planeswalkers reskinned as characters from the Hatsune Miku virtual verse. Unfortunately, these are some pretty mediocre planeswalkers. Freyalise, Llanowar's Fury, is a commander planeswalker that ticks up to generate pseudo Llanowar elf tokens, ticks down to naturalize something, and ultimates fairly quickly. She is arguably the strongest planeswalker in this drop, and obviously sees some commander play. She's worth a little over $1.50. Jace, Unraveler of Secrets, was a fine planeswalker in Standard, though it does follow the boring tick up to draw a card, tick down for removal, ultimate to win the game planeswalker templating that modern designs have strayed from. This version of Jace hasn't seen much play anywhere since leaving Standard. Elspeth Tyrell was the original Elspeth planeswalker card, the OG, and also the most often forgotten of the bunch. That's probably because out of all of the Elspeths in the multiverse, this version of her is likely the worst. And as a result, she sees little play anywhere, including Commander. She's worth 65 cents. And non-foil. The Royal Scions saw some Standard play and every so often make their way into Pioneer as well. It's a 3-mana planeswalker that ticks up to 6 loyalty from the same set that had another 3-mana planeswalker that ticked up to 6 loyalty, but did so in a much more memorable and broken manner. The real value in this drop is Liliana of the Dark Realms, a $15 card, despite seeing play in only a small fraction of EDH decks and nowhere else. Honestly, the fact that Liliana of the Dark Realms still costs $15 $1 million after so many, many reprints is astounding. But as you can see, overall, the other four walkers have no financial value in non-foil. There's a decent foil value, however, and so the grade here is a D and a B, quite the gap, and a reminder that even the least valuable Hatsune Miku Secret Lair drops had mediocre cards within them that still sold for a lot of money, and our grade here is, as always, reflective simply of the financial reprint value when looking at the cheapest available versions of these cards. Up next is a drop of blue cards drawn by comic book artist Peach Momoko. Remember, as always, that artwork is subjective, and that there is nothing wrong with buying Secret Lairs for the artwork. However, financially speaking, there's really not much here. Aether Eyes, after all, is a 29-cent card. This pseudo-sweeper for blue decks gets reprinted in pre-cons fairly frequently, and like many of these cards, it sees no play outside of Commander. Drown in Dreams is a card draw slash mill spell split card, originally from a Midnight Hunt pre-con. It's fine, I guess. And this is the first time that it will be available in foil, but I doubt that means much when the non-foil version is worth 23 cents. Psychic Corrosion is another mill spell, I guess that's the theme here, though this one is much better than the others as it's a constant, repeatable effect. This card actually has some value as it is worth about $5 in non-foil and three times that in foil. Visions of Beyond also carries some value with it, as it's Ancestral Recall in a dedicated mill deck anyway. It's a great card in Modern Mill, and sees play in Commander as well. Time Sieve is actually an old favorite of mine, a sweet card that's a bit hard to abuse, but allows for a pile of various infinite turn combos. Its most notable usage these days is as a combo piece for Aspiring Spike's Modern Brews, but it's definitely good in Commander as well. Unfortunately, the financial value of both non-foil and foil are flat fails. Again, I've got to stress that grade is reflective of the fact that you'd be spending $30 for $7 worth of cards, or $40 for $10 worth of cards. That's the fail. It in no way is a reflection of the skill and quality of the artwork, and if you love it, get it. But it's worth noting it's $7 to $10 worth of cards. Our next drop is Tome of the Astral Sorceress, which contains four cards designed by folk artist Helvetica Blanc. Again, art is subjective, but I think the art on these cards is gorgeous. The financial value, again, not so much. Maybe this shouldn't have only been a four-card drop. The most impressive card in which is Back to Basics, which used to see a lot of Legacy play but doesn't much anymore, though still carries a decent price tag due to its shallow reprint history. Preordain, a dollar or so card, was unbanned in Modern about a year ago and has been a staple of the format ever since. It is one of the best cantrips ever and sees play in any format where it's legal. Unfortunately, it's also a common that has been reprinted into oblivion. Sphinx of the Second Sun is a powerful top-end card for blue decks in Commander, despite costing eight, it's effectively zero mana, since you can cast it in your pre-combat main phase, then go to your second main and untap all your lands. Finally, Teferi's Ageless Insight is the epitome of a win more card, as it doubles your card draw output on any card draw spells or permanents that you have. In Commander, this is a great effect, but outside of Commander, this card sees no play and is again worth about $1.50, which brings the total value of the non-foils in this collection to $12.35. That's a fail. And the foil versions of these cards would cost you a whopping $21.90, which is also a fail, despite the awesome artwork and rainbow foiling. If nothing else, I do wish that these artist drops always had a minimum of 5 cards, and possibly some bonus tokens and things thrown in to increase the value. It's such a shame to have such a low financial value associated with such great artwork. Coming up next, we have Showcase, Duskmourn, House of Horror, the Secret Lair drop. This is a set of 5 cards that are reprinted in the Duskmourn horror art style to look like something you'd see on a 1980s TV screen, I guess? But hey, it's got Phyrexian Metamorph, a card that's very near and dear to my own heart as it was my very first Friday Night Magic win promo, and an all-around great card that sees play, especially in artifact decks. It's also a cube staple, and worth just under $5 in non-foil and above $12 in foil. Gothy Voidwalker is itself a very powerful graveyard hate card with a restrictive mana cost. It's great in Modern, and sometimes even good in Legacy. And both Commander and Cube players love it as well, giving it a really good value at $9.08 in non-foil, and $16 and change in foil, hey! And speaking of powerful cards, this drop also includes Magus of the Moon, which is a Blood Moon strapped to a 2/2 body. It's really good relevant and modern, though it has become a little outshined by Harbinger of the Seas in the Postmodern Horizons 3 metagame. It's also decent in Commander for all you Blood Moon Commander-loving psychopaths out there. The drop also includes both Cauldron Familiar and Witch's Oven, two halves to a very, very strong and very, very annoying, repeatable sack, fodder, and outlet combo that is the backbone of the Pioneer Sacrifice archetype. Given how highly played this combo is in Pioneer, and the fact that you need four copies of each for your decks, I wouldn't be surprised if these alternate art variants carried a lot more value than the originals do. But those originals, as you can see, are only worth $2.70 and $1.60 in non-foil, and not that much more in foil, bringing the total value of the non-foil version of this drop to $24.89, which I'm going to put at a D+. In foil, we get there to $56.90, another solid B, and I do actually think this is a pretty solid collection of cards, and again, that the Cauldron Familiar and Witch's Oven of this drop are very likely to be worth significantly more than their non-Secret Lair versions. In Monstrous Magazines, five creatures get a horror comics art style treatment makeover. And I don't know what's scarier, the artwork on these cards or me trying to read them. This drop includes Ravenous Chupacabra, an 11-cent card. Hey, it was great in Limited and Standard, but it really hasn't seen much play in any other constructed format. I'm not even sure too many Commander decks are gonna run it. In contrast, the Crawl Death Priest is a powerful Commander card that sees a lot of play in the 99 of sack decks. It triggers off of any player sacrificing a permanent, which is a big deal in Commander. We also have one of the most popular Voltron commanders here, Ural the Mist Stalker, which provides you with three great colors for auras, an ever-growing stat line, and of course, natural hex proof. These days, there's a lot of options for great Voltron commanders, but Ural remains one of the best. Coma, Cosmos Serpent, was another obscenely broken card in Limited that was also great in Standard. Unlike Chupacabra, Coma does see play in Pioneer from time to time as a sideboard card for big mana decks against Azurius Control. It's also a really good top-end in Commander decks, and that at least gives it a value of $3.77 in non-foil and $6 and change in foil. Last up is Doom Whisperer, which was one of the best cards in Guilds of Ravnica Standard, but promptly fell off once more sets entered that Standard rotation. It's still a decent, if unassuming, card in Commander, where you have a lot of life to play with. Total overall value in non-foil is $15.60, and in foil, you've got $29.11 worth of cards selling. So I guess grades are a D and a D+. This Secret Lair has some good cards, but it didn't quite get there financially. Up next is the first of three Universes Beyond Secret Lair drops, and it's Slimer from Ghostbusters. Remember Slimer? Financial value aside, most of the cards for this drop feel pretty shoehorned in, rather than an organic pairing of crossover and original IP. For example, the Mimeoplasm, while a solid Commander card, doesn't really feel like Slimer to me. Honestly, before this drop, if you were to ask Ghostbusters fans what they think a Slimer card would do, I can't imagine many, if any, would say, oh, you know, the Mimeoplasm. That's whose mechanics are really reminiscent of Slimer. Nor do I see how Pernicious Deed has anything to do with Slimer's buffet-gobbling appetite. This is indeed a good card, a classic sweeper effect, that sees decent play in Commander, especially in Muldrotha decks, as it can be replayed from the graveyard, but how is this related to the Universes Beyond scene that's being depicted here? Incarnation Technique is a sweet double reanimate spell for Commander, at the cost of another player at the table reanimating something as well. Great card, I don't see how this has anything to do with Slimer. It's kind of a Ghostbuster-y thing in general, reanimating the dead, but again, the connection feels flimsy at best. Windfall is a highly accessible wheel in Commander from a price standpoint, and I guess is connected to Slimer's feast in that he's getting more food, right? I don't know, your guess is as good as mine. It's a $2.23 card. The real standout in this drop is Trickbind, whose artwork I assume avoids us paying Bill Murray any royalties. Trickbind is a decent stifle effect in Commander as it's uncounterable, and it gets better the higher powered the format is, as it hard counters the Thassa's Oracle wincons, among many others. And as this is its first reprinting in foil, it carries a $96.30 value value, which brings the total foil value of this drop to $113.83, and that's not even counting Incarnation Technique, as this is not only that card's first reprint, but its first foil reprint as well. Value in non-foil is not quite as close at $30.69. I'll begrudgingly give that non-foil drop a C, and the foil collection a B+. Held back from an A because, of course, Trickbind being a $96 foil is one of those skewed pricing models that I don't think is indicative of an overall truly powerful reprinting of cards. The second Ghostbusters drop is The Real Ghostbusters, a cartoon show that I as a child loved more than I could possibly describe, which is why I can't help but feel disappointed at the choices of cards that have been collected here, not even so much for financial value, but because of the fact that they just don't make a lot of sense to me. How is Ghostbusters patch a Boros charm? I just don't understand. Do the Ghostbusters tap it with their hand and suddenly gain double strike? I suppose it makes about as much sense as Eldamri's call being Answer the Call, which is actually not a phrase from The Real Ghostbusters, but rather from the reboot movie, though I don't know, I guess they're answering the call in the cartoon as well. It's a great creature tutor, don't get me wrong, and actually has really solid true value in both non-foil and foil, as you'll see in a moment. I just don't get the connection. It has the word call in it. That's the connection. They looked for a card with the word call in it and said Answer the Call, and Answer the Call wasn't from the cartoon show. Careful study is Slimer wearing glasses. I again don't see the connection. I guess there was an episode of the cartoon show where he put on glasses or something. But again, the character of Slimer was not a careful studier. Living End makes more sense as a total containment failure, a staple of the surprise, surprise Living End archetype in Modern. This card has seen a lot of play for a lot of years and does see some play in Commander as well, though most in EDH would rather just cast Living Death and get the same effect right away. The most flavorful of all of these cards is also the least valuable, with Unlicensed Hearse being Ecto-1. But honestly, this is a huge flavor win. This is the sort of thing that they should be looking for when finding cards to reprint as Universes Beyond versions. Overall, the total non-foil value of this drop is $18.58, that's a flat D, and the foil version is $78.26, in no small part due to the fact that Careful Study carries a nearly $40 price tag in foil, and Eladromery's Call carries a nearly $20 one. I'll go ahead and give that a B grade, as I do think foil versions of Boros Charm and Living End have a reasonable value as well. Financial value aside, I really can't help but feel that both of these Ghostbusters drops could have done a much better job mining Magic's history to create Universes Beyond versions for this beloved franchise. Speaking of beloved franchises, up next is Child's Play. Hey look, it's a Chucky-themed reskin drop with art featuring the evil doll itself, my buddy! I'm a bit surprised that they went with Cardor as their Chucky stand-in, when there's plenty of actual dolls they could have chosen, including Marvin from Duskmorn, that actually is Chucky. That's Chucky, right? Marvin is Chucky. Oh well, Cardor is a good card in Rakdos-based Punisher, Group Slug, and Goad-based Commander decks, but it carries a 25 cent price tag in non-foil, and 34 cent price tag in foil, so oh well. Phyrexian Reclamation is a good card in Rakdos-based Punisher, Group Slug, and Goad-based Commander decks. As I never really watched much of the Chucky movies, you'll have to tell me if you feel this is a good fit for Sorry, Jack, Chucky's back. And likewise, if Varagoth, Blood Sky Sire, is the correct skin for Tiffany, Bride of Chucky. It's a pretty good card in the 99 of most Vampire Commander decks, but doesn't really have much use elsewhere. Twin Flame, otherwise known as Friends to the End, is a good card in Commander primarily, where copying creatures is great and you're likely to have the mana for additional Strive costs. It doesn't see much play anywhere else. Genesis Chamber is reskinned as Play Pal's Factory, a cool and unique card for Commander. It's especially great in a deck like Urza that can tap the chamber to prevent your opponents from getting the beneficial effect. It's worth $1.78 in non-foil, but its $10 foil value helps bring the total foil value of this drop to $72.20, a severely elevated value due to Phyrexian Reclamation being a $53 foil. It's $13 in non-foil, which is a fail, and I will only give it a begrudging C because without that Phyrexian Reclamation, the foil value here is next to non-existent. I guess you could say the most terrifying thing about these drops is their financial value, huh? Huh? So there's no Hatsune Miku in a Ghostbusters outfit. Then what's the point? Gotta go. I hope very much that us covering the secret layers early has been of some help to you. In fact, I really want to hear from you. Did you like this method or do you have issues with it? Let me know which you prefer in the comments below. And remember that I am giving away every single product that was released with Duskborn, from Duskborn Play Booster Boxes to Duskborn Collector Booster Boxes to one of every Duskborn Commander Precon and whatever other products were in Duskborn. Duskborn, I'm giving it all away on September 30th on my Whatnot stream. All you have to do is tune in and you might walk away with free magic swag. Best of all, when you use my invite code, you get a $15 credit to spend on items on anyone's store on Whatnot. So take $15 worth of magic products on me. Just go to www.whatnot.com/invite/Tolarian College to get your $15 credit and then tune in on September 30th and maybe walk away with some Duskborn swag from me to you. And thank you, Whatnot, for sponsoring this video.
Next time on Shuffle Up and Play.
Today, we are janking each other off. This is a jank-off. The criteria, which I hope we all followed this time. No card in the deck can be more than $1, including your commander.
I think this is a ruse.
Don't use big words around me, sir.
It's got four letters. It's more than three.
Right.
Lord of math.
Right. Judge, this card costs more than $1.
I'm not going to let a whole table sass me.
What are you doing? I'm not done. What are you doing there?
It's my nervous tick when I drop from 40 to 11 in one turn cycle.
So we're gonna move to combat. I'm not just that type of guy, but I'm gonna hit this man in the face.
Tell me how
so
much
we're
damage.
Gonna go to combat.
I'm gonna roll with absolute cruelty. I mean, I'm the one.
Just like back home.
Wow.